This is Michael Woodward, and this is Season 2, Episode 59 of the Jumble Think Podcast.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1...
Welcome to the Jumble Think Podcast, a podcast where we interview some of the leading entrepreneurs around the world. These dreamers, makers, innovators, and influencers will share their tips of how you can turn your ideas and dreams into reality too. Our guest on today's episode is Cody Wanner. More about Cody in a moment. There are exciting things going on at the Jumble Think Podcast, and we want to make sure you know about them. So in last week's episode, Season 2, Episode 58, we talked about exciting changes to the Jumble Think Podcast and our new podcast coming out in late September called The B-Side. In that episode, we also gave you 3 tips to making your dream a reality. If you haven't checked out that episode already, I would encourage you to go check it out right after our episode with Cody. Now let's jump into today's episode. Hey there, welcome to the Jumble Think Podcast. My name is Michael Woodward. I am your host. We have an incredible episode lined up for you today. Before we dive into that, I want to encourage you, wherever you like to listen to your podcast, head on over, click the subscribe button, and listen to the podcast right there. If you like listening to podcasts on iTunes or Apple Podcasts, all you have to do is go to jumblethink.com/iTunes. And if you like listening on Spotify, jumblethink.com/Spotify. What it's going to do is it's going to take you right to the app, right to where you can click subscribe. We've made it super easy. So go do that right now. Click that subscribe button and become part of the Jumble Think family. I am super excited about today's guest. His name is Cody Wanner. I've known him for a little while now. We met through the church we actually go to. Cody is an entrepreneur and a vlogger from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. He started his video production company, Cap Collective, 5 years ago, and he started vlogging at the beginning of 2018. Cody is passionate about encouraging the world of doers, and he's started a new trend called No Small Creator. It is really, really shaking up the world of creativity and really bringing value back to creatives. He's been on an interesting journey. We're going to talk about that, about vlogging, about entrepreneurship, and so much more in today's episode. So let's welcome our guest today, Cody Wanner. Our guest today is Cody... What is it, Wanner or Wainer?
It's good. You should leave this in, actually, because everybody asked this question.
Yeah.
It's Wanner. It rhymes with honor. So Cody Wanner rhymes with honor. But I always say, I don't care how you say my name. I'm just happy you're talking about me.
Oh, so good. So good. You are doing a lot of things. It seems like that's a trend with all of our guests. People that are doing things do a lot of things and make lots of impacts. You definitely do that. You have a business called Cap Collective. Mm-hmm. I always want to say creative, but it's collective.
Cap Creative is kind of cool too.
You are a vlogger utilizing YouTube. You have a small child and a wife and a family, and you got a lot going on. When people ask you, mm-hmm, how you define yourself in the world of entrepreneurship, what would you tell them?
How I define myself? At the most basic level, I'm a creator.
Okay.
So I create systems and structures occasionally to run within my company so that the company can run fluidly and hopefully at some point completely without me.
Yeah.
I create videos, obviously, daily with vlogging. I create photos. I create relationships. I create experiences with my kids. And so at the very core, you know, as an entrepreneur, I think I'm a creator.
So cool. I love that. Now, Cap Collective is your main business.
Right.
Now, you founded that how long ago?
5 years ago.
5 years ago. Crazy, crazy. And did you start that on your own or you're in a partnership? How does that look?
Yeah. So I started freelance on my own 6 years ago.
Okay.
And then met up with 2 other freelancers who are married.
Yeah.
And doing the same thing. We went to the same school. We graduated from the same program in the same year.
Wow.
And, you know, we were definitely... It was a small program, so we were acquaintances. Like, we weren't best friends in school, but we were together, and we were friends.
Yeah.
And said to them, I don't want you as competitors. I want you as my partners, and we started Cap Collective together.
Super cool. Now, you mentioned that CAP Collective obviously stands for capital, as in like Harrisburg Capital, I would assume.
Right.
You do video production. What does that look like? Because video production can mean weddings, it can mean commercial, it can mean documentary. There's a wide spectrum of what video means. What does that mean for you?
So we literally do all the things that you just listed.
Okay.
Wedding, commercial, and documentary. We incorporate aerial into all of those things, but also it is kind of its own breakout just because of it's a trend right now. So it's something that's highly marketable.
Right.
So we generally incorporate aerial video and stuff, but we do just also do standalone aerial video. Right. So the way I think about it is there's three different categories of video. On the far left, there's DIY video. That's what you can, you have a 4K camera in your pocket, most likely. You can pull that out and get some really
great
stuff.
Your cell phone, right.
Exactly. Yeah. As a small business or whatever your brand you're building, you can do awesome DIY stuff. Almost everybody can do awesome DIY stuff with their phone. On the other end of the spectrum, there's highly produced video.
Yeah.
And that is where CAP Collective focuses. So it's something you might see on TV, a commercial, but it takes multiple takes. It takes pre-production and lighting and everyone being on the same page, scripting and storyboarding and shot listing and all of that. So that's highly produced. In the middle, there's something I like to call level up video or vlog style video. So it's basically a hybrid between the two. It's using kind of a more advanced camera, but to sort of do DIY stuff in a very run and gun type way.
Yeah.
And that's vlog style video.
Super cool. And you do that, of course, with your YouTube vlog, which, how can people find that?
That is my name, R. Cody Wanner.
What's the R stand for?
R stands for Robert.
Okay.
Robert's my first name.
Yeah. I don't think most people know that.
No, they don't. They don't. That's true. That's a good question. A lot of people ask me on YouTube, what's the R? Because a lot of people, because I think Reddit, a lot of people think that it stands for like real, like the real Cody Wanner.
Yeah.
Some people ask me, is it robot? Are you talking about AI? I'm like, I like all of those things. That's fantastic. But no, it's my first name is Robert. So you can just pop on YouTube, search Cody Wanner, and I'll be the first one to pop up. I have a purple profile picture. It kind of looks like I'm jumping up in the air.
Nice. Very cool. I want to go back in time, way back, way, way, way back.
Nice.
So for you, how did this passion and journey start? Because you can tell in the way you talk, whether it's your YouTube channel or talking about your business, this is something that you love. It's a part of your core. Mm-hmm. How for you did that start?
It started for me in skateboarding.
Okay.
We started skating and our parents had video cameras. We got these video cameras out, started recording these tricks. I love the fact that we could play back our tricks and see what we were doing wrong and right and how it looked, and it was very cool.
Yeah.
So these tricks were super fantastic, and I loved watching it. We loved then started cutting them together and making these highlight reels.
Yeah.
And as I kind of transitioned out of skateboarding as my main thing, I still loved the idea of making these recap videos. So I started doing that with friends in high school.
Yeah.
And it really went from there to I did some traveling right after high school. And we went over to Turkey. I did kind of three recap videos of this whole trip to Turkey.
Wow.
And then studied it in college and then transitioned out of college into, having a love for it. I didn't go immediately into the field right after college. I was in fundraising first. And then when I started my own thing, the skill that I had was video.
That's super, super cool. For you now, you've been doing this for several years.
Yeah.
Is this what you studied at Messiah?
It is.
Okay. So you went in knowing that this is kind of the direction you wanted to go, where I think a lot of us go into school and end up in the farthest reaches of what was possible.
Right. I had the luxury of taking a year between high school and college.
Yeah,
so
yeah, yeah.
I think oftentimes when there's a little bit of a gap there, it helps to kind of more focus. Okay, this is, I think, what I actually want to do.
Yeah, I am a big fan of that. I did that myself before I went to ministry school and then dropped out.
I was going to say, like, right, like, what's your degree? Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, there's a long story about that. It was very good. I got offered a job doing what I wanted to do for the people I wanted to do it for, so why the heck stay in school?
Yeah. Said almost every entrepreneur ever.
Yes,
you know,
yes.
That's fantastic.
So for you, you've been doing this for a while. You have staying power. You aren't here today, gone tomorrow. This is a hobby. This is the real deal for you. So for you, you talk all about creating, and you talk about passion and purpose and destiny and dreaming. For you, how are you finding purpose and significance in what you're creating?
I find purpose most, most directly in the vlog that I get to do, the daily vlog.
Okay.
So my purpose and passion in life is to encourage other people. I've always been an encourager in person, you know?
Okay.
So conversations happening and I pick up on XYZ and I try to dig into that a little bit. How could I encourage you there? YouTube gave me the ability to do that at a much larger scale and in a way that is accessible by many more people. You know, it's so just daily being able to take what's in my head, take what's on my mind and the struggles and the failures that I'm going through and then kind of repackage them and broadcast them out, which is what YouTube is in essence, broadcasting, broadcast them out in a way that it's like, look, what if we framed it like this and turned it into something that is helpful or encouraging or could be beneficial. And just doing that for myself has been so empowering and helping create a self-awareness in me, but then also, it has, thankfully encouraged many people and that's fantastic.
Super, super cool. We always like to ask this question. What is one challenge you're currently working to overcome in your own business? And I think in the broader sense, you can incorporate the YouTube stuff, your daily vlog as a part of that. So what's one of those challenges?
I'd say one of our main challenges at Cap Collective is kind of the ethos of the market that we're currently in. And maybe I don't know that this is anything new or like unique to us,
right?
But just creating exposure, creating awareness about the power of video marketing.
Okay.
It doesn't seem, I almost expect when I start talking to somebody new that when I say we do video marketing, that they'll say, oh, yeah, we're doing XYZ for video marketing. This is how we do it.
Yeah.
Or they'll say, oh my goodness, I need to talk to you about that because we need to incorporate that.
Yeah.
But so often, instead we hear like, oh, what's that?
Right.
And to me, that doesn't make sense because I see the power and value and kind of, video, having video as a part of your social presence and your online presence today is like the website of a couple of years ago.
Okay.
Right? And so that's sort of how I see it. So just creating that awareness and sort of ubiquity of video.
Okay. You know, I find that interesting because for 13 plus years, I lived in Northern California. I wasn't far from Silicon Valley, Sacramento, Napa. And coming back home, because I grew up here, I was shocked by the region, even in New York, when I go up there for meetings and client stuff, how far behind they are in thinking in a lot of these spaces, whether it's video integration, whether it's web and app development, how they're not as on bleeding edge. It kind of surprises me. Have you encountered that too?
So definitely here in Pennsylvania, there's a lot of that. I think less so in New York City for me. And also I've never lived on the West Coast, though I have heard anecdotally that the West Coast is more advanced when it comes to a lot of this tech stuff. I would say yes, that is generally the feel.
Yeah.
Is like, well, this is how we do it here. We do it relationally, we have strong networks of people. Digital's great as an add-on, but like we build our businesses based off relationships. And so the shift is, well, so do we,
yeah.
But they're just digitally mediated relationships.
Yeah.
And that's far more scalable and revenue generating and all of those things.
Right.
You know, it's like, yeah, no, we're not saying get rid of relationships. We're saying amplify them in a different way. So
yeah,
I totally hear that.
Now you are pivoting a lot of things that you do constantly, evolving it, changing it because technology is growing and the mediums are evolving.
Yeah.
For you, what's the next big goal that you have for your business and for you personally?
Mm-hmm. One of the things that we're doing with our business that I'm really excited about, a goal that we have, is creating a system that makes it incredibly easy for a client to come on board,
yeah,
to think about strategy and then work with us or delegate to us the execution of that strategy. You know, just kind of a system that is robust enough that it works, but simple enough that it works.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so creating that, I mean, and that honestly has been what we've been trying to do since the beginning.
Okay.
And it just takes time.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's changing. You kind of phrase the question about technology and how it's always changing. We're always having to pivot. I think it's interesting that, you know, in a sense that's true. And we're trying to stay on top of current trends in the market, but also current tech in the market.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's a tension and a balance there, but, it's really this age old idea of creating a turnkey, a turnkey business that you can teach somebody with a manual almost, and a couple of months of shadowing maybe, so that I think once we really understand it and have it in that form, that's going to be a huge value add to our clients as well because of kind of the awareness that we'll be able to bring to the table with each client. So creating that, just making it easier for clients to get their video done understand why it was done that way and, you know, less revisions through the process. That's a big thing. I mean, it's a simple thing, but that's really the biggest thing.
Super cool. We'll be back with Cody Wanner and going deeper into these topics and so much more. We love connecting with you, and we want to hear more of your stories. One of the best places to connect is Instagram. So here's what you need to do. Swing on over to jumblethink.com/Instagram. It will take you right to Instagram. Follow us. Let's connect up. Drop us a message right there, or comment on today's post and let us know what you thought of today's episode. Again, that's jumblethink.com/Instagram. It will take you right there. Follow us. We'll follow you. We'll be friends. It will be great. And we'll have a lot of fun along the way. So let's jump back into today's episode. We are back with Cody, going so much deeper into this. We're going to talk more about his YouTube stuff, what he's doing there. We're going to also talk more about creating and being a creator and doing that. Before we start into this, one of the things I wanted to talk about is, you know, I've known you for a couple months now. There are those people that I meet that I just instantly like understand. And then there's those people that I just can't quite put my finger and understand them and figure out. You fall into the second category.
Oh, fun.
Like just trying to wrap my head around you and who you are.
Mm-hmm.
So for you, as you're creating, as you're doing, as you're interacting with people, what is that core part of you that is the driving factor on how you create, how you think and process ideas and idea creation?
Wow. Ideas come to me. I have ADHD, okay. So I get a lot of ideas every day.
Right.
So idea creation, I think, does come through self-awareness, but also surrounding and environment awareness.
Okay. Yeah.
As my life is happening, I'm seeing, oh, there's an idea, and I'm jotting them down.
Right.
I think my idea list has 213 ideas on it right now.
So I want to pause you there for a second.
Sure.
So you're saying about jotting them down. Do you have like a little notebook where...
No.
Or how do you, like on your phone, little iPhone notes and that kind of thing?
Yeah, I use Evernote.
Okay.
Because I pay for the subscription version. I think it's $8 a month.
Yeah.
But you can scan business cards on it and it turns the text editable and searchable. So I really like that. And then you can also do voice memos and kind of just keeps it all in one spot.
Yeah.
But Yeah, so Evernote. I would love to use a manual notebook, but I'm just generally driving or, you know, doing something that I can't stop and jot it down.
So voice memos or voice to text is like a lifesaver in those moments.
Yeah, you look back at most of my notes and they're incomprehensible. You know what I mean? Because it's voice to text, but thankfully I can track the Siri thought process, right? Yeah. And I'm like, all right, yeah, that's what I was going to talk about.
Oh, that's so cool. Mm-hmm. And then turning an idea, because we both create a lot, but it's very different. Mm-hmm. Because with like the podcast, you know, I'm interviewing a lot of people. Sometimes it's topical. For every two episodes, I try to do one topical where it's just me. For mm-hmm. you, you're creating every day. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the process of creating looks probably very different because mm-hmm. of what we're creating. Mm-hmm. So how do you take that process and first off, I mean, you talk about ADHD and just having all these ideas, which is probably a benefit when you're creating every day a vlog. But how do you start turning that idea into an actual tangible product through the vlog or through whatever you're doing? How do you process that and then convert that into something that other people can grasp? Other people can like really start riding the train with you on that.
Right. Yeah, I mean, that's the magic part, right? Okay. When you take an idea from idea to execution to product, that's like what lights me up.
Right.
I love that.
Okay.
So I will make the distinction just between documentation and creation. Vlogging, in large part, is documentation. So it's a matter of this is what I'm doing. I'm documenting it, and I'm maybe talking about what's happening.
Right. So in a way, it's a daily diary and digest version of your life.
Exactly.
Okay.
So oftentimes, you know, I'd say probably 50 to 60% of the time, that's what my daily vlog looks like.
Right.
There's many daily vlogs that would be more like 80 to 90% of the time documenting because their life is interesting enough that, you know, they can document it and we want to watch it, right?
Yeah.
Creating, on the other hand, is I believe harder.
Okay.
And it's when you get an idea that doesn't have to do with document. So oftentimes I'll get a documenting idea.
Okay.
You know, and I'm like,
what's
okay,
an example of that?
So that would be like the other day I had a sales meeting and then we also had a first year high school. So a freshman, incoming freshman shadowing that day.
Yeah.
And I took him, you know, I thought what an interesting vlog idea to take someone, mm-hmm. you know, that young to an actual sales meeting that I'd never done that when I was in ninth grade.
Right. Right.
And, you know, and ask the person, can I record this entire meeting?
Right.
And kind of show that on the vlog as a really interesting idea.
Yeah.
So that's a documenting idea. I didn't have to do anything above and beyond. I just realized, oh, this is a cool documentation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Creating, on the other hand, is there's an idea in my head. It's kind of outside of my normal life.
Right.
And I want to execute it in a way that is fun and new and different. It's like making something new that wouldn't happen without trying to make it happen.
Yeah. So like one of your, I don't know. I don't see your stats. I watch the videos, but I don't always read through the comments. We're both busy. I think you probably understand how it is. Sometimes there are a lot of things you want to do, you just don't have time to do.
And then you forget if you did them or not. You're like, I'm going to tweet out this video. And then you're like, I never did it.
Yeah. And so it appeared, at least from my point of view, you did this video where there was a flying unicorn and a flying Cody.
Yeah.
And you have to see it. It's super fun. And it seemed like there were a lot of questions about the technicality of building that.
Right.
So would that be an example of a video that was more of a conceptual versus a documenting?
100%.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and again, the difference is, like, I took time out of my day to create that.
Yeah.
I wasn't documenting my day. Yeah. I was going and doing something that was outside of my normal schedule to figure out how to make it look like a unicorn floaty is flying and figure out how to make it look like I'm going to fly up. And there's a point in that video where I, you know, kind of take a step back and I say, this is the point in the video where you wonder, is this going to work?
Yeah,
you
know what I mean? You're kind of crouching looking
right,
at the, I remember that.
Is this going to work? Because you just don't know when you're, and you only have a day to do it.
Right.
So you can't come and reshoot it tomorrow when you're going daily. Or you can chalk it up as a failure and try the whole thing over the next day. But and that's something that I love about the whole process. That, yeah, so that's creation.
Okay. And for you, you talk about documentation versus creation in that space. I'm assuming that documentation is a little bit easier because you're able to let it tag along with your day. But then you're still trying to put a cohesive story behind that and or theme. So when you go into a documenting day, are you thinking, okay, I've got all this stuff to do, and I know that there's a commonality here, and this is the theme or story that I want today to capture? Or do you just go in and kind of let it happenstance to you, and whatever happens, happens, and then you try to craft that narrative together afterwards?
Yes to both of those.
Okay.
So I'd say probably... on a documenting day, probably 80% of the time, it's the latter, where the day's just happening, and I'm just like, I got to do this day.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to pick up shots the whole day.
Yeah.
But then I'm not going to be able to figure out what it means until afterwards.
Yeah.
And how to story it until afterwards, right?
Yeah.
The better way to do it is the first way that you described it, which is like to think about what is my day, who are the main action takers?
Yeah.
And what problems are they going to face?
Yeah.
So it's probably just you. You know, if you're vlogging, it's probably just you. You're the main action taker, unless you're like with somebody that day or whatever.
Yeah.
You need to think about the problems. What are the challenges? What's the thing that you're going to have to overcome?
Right.
And then how? What's the resolution going to look like?
Yeah.
And just even just thinking about that for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Helps you kind of sculpt your day in a way that it's going to be good for the vlog, but in reality, is most likely going to be good for you and your life.
Yeah,
because you've thought it through, you've kind of envisioned, you visualize what you want to see happen, what's going to be hard, what's going to be easy, and how you're going to get through it. And just, I think even that process of just taking your mind on that path is incredibly helpful. So I do that 20% of the time.
You know, you are doing both styles.
Mm-hmm.
Which one do you enjoy more?
100% I enjoy creating more.
Okay.
It's just, for me, when I get an idea, I get so excited about it, and I want it. I want to turn it into reality so bad.
Yeah.
And I just got an idea yesterday morning. I left it out of the vlog for today, but I was talking to the camera about this idea and how I don't have the resources right now to do it. I need more shots. I think I need to travel a little bit.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's just so hard because I start thinking about it.
Yeah.
And I can't stop thinking about it because I'm so excited about it. And so that's a challenge for sure. But hands down, if I had unlimited resources, I would create. Yeah. I would create every day.
Isn't that the most frustrating thing to be like, I have such a cool concept, at least in my head, and I don't have the resources or maybe the time, or most of the time it's the money to pull it off.
Right.
That's so frustrating. How do you still have to create at times and figure out how to overcome those obstacles? Mm-hmm. So when you are processing like, this is a killer idea.
Yeah.
I've just got to do it.
Yep.
How do you start overcoming those obstacles to make that a reality then?
Yeah. You know, that is a fantastic question. And I think, you know, there's this skill of how do we use what we've got to do what we can.
Yeah.
Instead of the worst thing is to say, I don't have the resources, I'm not gonna do it.
Right. Just give up.
Just give up and be like, I don't have the resources, I can't get this done.
Yeah.
You know, if you have a plan for getting the resources and you're putting that plan into motion, then by all means wait and, you know, wait until next month or wait even maybe until next year.
Yeah.
When you know you're gonna be able to get it done in the right way and whatever. But even just, I mean, key step there is you're putting a plan into action. You're taking steps towards it.
Yeah, you're still doing stuff. You're not just going, okay, well, like in a year
someday,
I'll be ready.
Exactly.
Yeah.
By all means. But if there's no plan, if you have no plan to get the resources to buy a rocket ship or whatever your idea is, you know, then figure out how to make the rocket ship, figure out how to get someone else to help you make the rocket ship. And it's not going to look as good, you know, it's not going to be this perfect thing that you've envisioned, but it's going to be something. It's going to be in existence. It's going to be viewable.
Yeah.
I'm talking about videos, but this, you know, this applies to everything. A product, with relationships, with your kids. You know, we have these great ideas that we want to do with our kids as fathers, right?
Yeah.
And you can't do all the stuff that you want to do with your kids, but you can do something.
Yeah.
And just making something is so much better than making nothing. Having an imperfectly executed idea is so much better than just an idea.
Yeah. I love that. And, you know, for a lot of people listening, they may have an idea, they may have a dream, and we're all about dreamers. You are too, I know that. And let's just take what you do and let's put them in your shoes.
Okay.
And they are wanting to start a vlog.
Yeah.
And they just go, well, maybe it's the resources. I just don't know. Don't I need like a DSLR
right.
or some kind of killer camera?
Right.
The other obstacle is often fear, like,
what if it fails? Right.
What will people think?
Right.
And I think the other thing is, and you talked about this with Peter McKinnon, and we'll talk more about that in a moment, but this whole idea of like, to boil it down, I'm a fraud. Why would people care?
Yeah.
So for you in that process, I know that you had to overcome those same fears, those same obstacles, those same doubts.
Yeah.
If somebody's starting something, and specifically, let's say a vlog, what do they need to know going into it so their eyes are wide open and they can say, okay, I know that I'm going to feel or experience this coming up.
Yeah.
And okay, that's okay. I just got to push through or whatever that is.
Yep.
What are some of those tips you'd give them?
I just had a new someone who wanted to start a vlog comment on a vlog from the other day asking a similar question.
Yeah.
And just saying, you know, I am so afraid of what people are going to think when I'm holding my camera or my phone out in front of me.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's address that one right off the bat. You have your camera. It's probably in your pocket. You can vlog with your phone. If you want to start a vlog, you don't need a $3,000 DSLR.
Right.
Just start it with your phone and then figure it out from there. Right.
Okay.
So we'll get that off the table. The fear of other people and what they'll think of you. I told that commenter, I kind of envy you in your position where you're at.
Yeah.
Because for me, it took 113 vlogs in a row to conquer, quote unquote, that fear. So I say conquer, quote unquote, because I still feel it daily.
Right.
You know, every fear doesn't. We are community creatures. We care, you know, we care about what everyone around us is thinking.
Yeah.
To some degree.
Yeah.
So when you get a weird look or when you you start to feel that hair raise up on the back of your neck because you know someone's looking at you weird.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's not easy, and you have to overcome that daily. So, but the reason I kind of envy them is because being able to every day get up and face a fear, like have the courage to take to move straight into an uncomfortable position is the one of the most amazing things to be able to do.
Yeah.
So let's take it back to the business side. You know, people are terrified of cold calls, of calling somebody who you've never talked to. They have no idea who you are.
Right.
It's terrifying.
Yeah.
It's terrifying.
Yeah.
And it's uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's the worst.
Yeah.
But to be able to do it 100 times in a row.
Yeah.
And, you know, hang up the phone on that 100th time. You feel a lot different on that. Like, you might be sad because so many people told you no, right?
Yeah.
But even in that, you've had to figure out, how am I going to not let this affect my mood so that I don't ruin the rest of my day and week from all these no's? So just facing those fears, courage, you know, I preach courage over fearlessness.
Yeah.
It's not that you're trying to get rid of the fears in your life. It's that you're trying to face them in a way that you're taking note of how you're acting and what your body's doing and all of those things and feeling those things.
Yeah.
Because the sense of accomplishment in overcoming a fear and doing something that you were afraid to do, but you did it anyway.
Yeah.
To me, there's really no rush like that.
Yeah. So, so, so good. I think one of the struggles that I'm dealing with currently, and maybe you can speak to this because I think a lot of people experience this. You know, I went into the podcast and We all set unrealistic expectations. Oh, yeah. You know, for me, it's like, we'll be, it'd be no problem. We'll get, you know, 100,000 followers. There's like, you know, however, 139 million people in America.
Yeah.
You know, 100,000 people, that's nothing.
Right.
That's not the reality often. But I think one of the other things that is difficult and the struggle that like I was referencing a second ago is this whole notion of like, I'm going, okay, well, I'll build my social channels.
Yep.
I'll utilize those. I'll share the podcast episodes. I'll do some paid advertising and that kind of thing. But there's this whole thing of like, well, I'm not going to self-promote either. Mm. I'm not going to go out and be like, hey, Cody, hey, I'm starting this podcast.
Yeah.
Hey, can you like pump this out to all of your friends and that kind of thing? And it just feels like awkward. Mm-hmm. And that's the challenge I'm facing right now to go to the next level. Like we've done well on the podcast. We've had incredible guests. We've had a lot of people listen.
Right.
So now how do we get to the next level? And and I'm like going back and I'm like, I have to let people know.
Yeah.
Like people are like, well, what do you do? I'm like, well, I do web development. We consult. We do all that stuff. And then it's like, oh, and I have a podcast.
Yeah.
And the podcast is what really excites me.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah.
But it's like on the flip side, it's kind of like this whole thing, like a little bit of shame there. So how do you deal with that whole thing of utilizing your network in a healthy way so that you're promoting, but you don't feel like you're self-serving and you're self-promoting because it's like that dirty thing. You don't want to be that creepy car salesman.
Yeah.
You know, does that make sense?
It does. It totally does. That is, Mike, that is like the realest question I've ever been asked about this space that we're in.
Yeah.
I love it. Absolutely love it. So let me say it this way. I used to be in a network marketing company.
Okay.
A multi-level marketing company.
Lovely.
A lot of people call them pyramid schemes, right?
Yeah.
You got to call all your friends. You got to ask all your friends. It is terrible. It is the hardest thing in the world, right? Legitimate legal companies, most of them, right?
Yeah.
But very hard. Yeah. And I did that. I went hard at that. I tried as hard as I could at it. I failed miserably. I didn't make money. I lost a lot of money.
Right.
You know, just buying these products and not selling them.
Yeah.
In essence.
Yeah.
And not recruiting others to sell them.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I got out of, I stopped with that company.
Yeah.
And when I started my business and then now when I started this vlog.
Yeah.
I think back to that and I think if I was willing to for some other brand, for some other people who are making money off of me and my actions and efforts.
Yeah.
If I was willing to call my wife's sister's friend's mom and say, hey, would you consider coming to a meeting with me where other people are going to be, it's going to be high energy, we're going to have a flip chart.
Yeah.
If I was willing to do that for them,
yeah,
what am I afraid about? What am I willing to do for myself?
Right.
For my thing that I believe in. I believe.
Right.
I believe that this is my purpose.
Yeah.
This is why I'm here on the earth.
Yeah.
And so like what do I have to be afraid of?
Yeah.
Now that I actually really 100% believe that what I've got is something that other people need.
Oh, that's good.
You know? So for me, it's like, it's kind of the opposite.
Okay.
It feels like, how can I not tell everybody about this thing? Because I truly believe it is what's good for them.
Yeah.
And it's a tough thing, man. Yeah. It is tough. But so when I started the vlog, I would post on Facebook almost every single day.
I would
post the link on Facebook. Yeah. I would say, hey, check this out.
Yeah.
It was so hard because Facebook hates YouTube and, you know, you click the link. First off, there's no thumbnail unless you share it from your phone.
Let's be honest. Facebook just hates people. They hate businesses. They love your money, but they hate you.
I can either confirm nor deny that oh my goodness. Right. So Facebook makes it hard to watch a YouTube video.
They do.
Now.
Yeah.
And
because they want everything native. They don't want people living there. They won't even let the video pull in natively, which they should. It's so stupid.
Yeah, they won't do that anymore. They used to be like that. You used to be able to watch a YouTube video in line on Facebook, but you can't. And I understand, you know, they're in business. They're making money.
Right.
And they need people to stay on their platform, and that's where they generate their ad revenue. So, you know, there's no bad blood between me and Facebook other than some of the stuff that's like, well, let's work on that. And I think they're working on it.
Yeah.
You know, I'm good with Facebook.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it was hard. You know, it's hard to get someone to subscribe to your YouTube channel from Facebook because they have to click like 10 times
yeah.
to be able to get over there.
Yeah.
They're probably gonna have to log in and they're probably on their phone and they don't know their password for Gmail and YouTube because it's like saved on their computer.
Yeah.
So it's hard.
Yeah.
And I think I probably garnered 300 subscribers from my, I think I have a maybe 1,500 friends on Facebook, personal friends.
Yeah.
I think I garnered maybe 300, maybe more. Yeah. I don't know. There's really no way to know.
Yeah.
But I kept sharing it there and I kept on treating Facebook as my community, my family who was helping me win, who was helping me do this, regardless of whether it was still having a positive effect on the growth of the channel or not. I'm a huge believer in nobody got anywhere by themselves.
Yeah.
So like any way that anybody has ever helped me, I'm just giving them credit for it, regardless of how big or small it was.
Yeah.
So I did that for the first, for a very long time. And then it got to a point where the community got very well built on YouTube from around the world.
Yeah.
And I started much more engaging on YouTube. And then because of that on Twitter, which I believe Twitter's the most powerful social media that there is.
Yeah.
And so YouTube and Twitter became my main focus. Even Instagram, I was only using Instagram to push people to YouTube.
Yeah.
And so when this thing happened with Peter and he dropped the collab that he let the secret out on Instagram. It was a shock to my system of why was I not taking Instagram seriously?
Yeah. I love Instagram.
I had this massive audience and all I was doing was posting my thumbnails on my Instagram platform.
Yeah.
And so thankfully I was right there with him and I was like, what do I do? Like, what do I do now? He's like, dude, man, it's what you always say.
Yeah.
That's what he's like. You start now. You build your foundation now. Like, what do you want your Instagram to be?
Yeah.
And build it.
Yeah.
And so that's what I'm doing now with Instagram. But all that is to say, it doesn't, you know, use your personal network. I have a video.
Yeah.
I was at 462 subscribers, I believe.
Okay.
And I was trying to get to 500.
Yeah, I remember that.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think it was a Sunday.
Yeah.
It must have been a Saturday because the market was open in Harrisburg.
Okay.
And I started the video in my office and I said, basically what I just said to you of like, how much do you believe in this thing that you're trying to build?
Yeah.
Do you actually believe in it or not? Because if you don't, you should probably stop.
Yeah.
But if you do,
yeah,
why are you not willing to get out there on the streets? And then I hit the streets and I'm asking for subscribers in person.
Yeah.
Right. I'm walking up to people saying, hey, I have a YouTube channel. I try to encourage people.
Yeah.
At the time it was just creators and entrepreneurs. It's broadened since then. But, And I'm like, you know, it's energetic, it's fun. Do you want to take a look? I'd bring it right up on their phone and I'd ask them to subscribe to me right on the spot.
Yeah.
The idea being like, that's not how you're gonna build 100,000 followers, right?
Right.
But it's a mindset
of
I am willing to ask a stranger
in
real life
to
subscribe to me.
Yeah.
That puts you at a whole different level about what you are capable of, what you're willing to do, and how much you actually do believe in what you're doing.
Right.
And being in that headspace changes the game in what you're creating.
Yeah. Back to mindset. It always seems to be back to how you
think
and how you approach.
Right.
There's so much we can talk about. One of the things I really wanted to talk about was personal brand versus a business brand.
Yeah.
Especially in the creator space, because you look at like Casey Neistat and other people, and now they've created their media empires and they have their personal brand and everything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you navigate that for you? It's a little different because your business is separate from your your vlog and everything. So personal blog versus business brand, or personal brand versus business brand.
Yeah.
How do you think people should be approaching that?
I mean, so it's like everything now. It's all very connected.
Yeah.
It's all very interconnected.
Yeah.
You know, like the legal structures maybe or not. Maybe like your lawyer has to do some good work about how to keep them separate if they need to be separate. And intellectual property, that's really important.
Yeah.
You know, who owns what, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
But, you know, the fact that I'm building my personal brand has undoubtedly helped my corporate brand.
Right.
Immensely.
Yeah.
it's positioned us as an expert in this market.
Yeah.
It's positioned us as, you know, it's just straight up given us more visibility. It's generated more clicks to our website.
Yeah.
It's created, you know, a windfall of SEO for our website to help, you know, rank us higher.
Yeah.
So undoubtedly building a personal brand helps your corporate brand.
Yeah.
And the cool thing about it is they're very transferable. A corporate brand is a personal brand, but just for a company. So like,
yeah.
So a person can be on brand or off brand, just like a company can be on brand or off brand.
Right.
And so, but as, when it's personally, it's like, are you being yourself or you're not being yourself?
Yeah.
So when it's fun to kind of extrapolate that to a company, is it being itself or is it not being itself?
Yeah.
So they're very similar in how you build them. It's just, I think building a corporate brand is a lot harder because there's generally more people involved.
Yeah.
You know, I think in Simon Sinek's book, Start With Why,
yeah,
he talks about this, the basically the personality of the CEO is the brand of the company.
Yeah.
And that's interesting. That was really interesting to me when I heard that because I'm like, well, that simplifies it.
Yeah.
At least that simplifies it. Then it's like your personal brand is your corporate brand.
Yeah.
But I think it is a little bit more complex than that, actually. Yeah.
Well, and you look at Apple as a great example of that. We talk about that a lot. Apple is incredible, but just the shift in innovation from when Steve Jobs to Tim Cook.
Yep.
And Tim's incredible, but he's a business guy.
Yep.
And he's running Apple as a business, not as an innovation hub, although there's a lot of innovation going there. So it's just a different approach. Like I said, a billion things we could talk about.
Yeah.
The last thing that I really want to hit in this segment that
cool.
I think is so significant, it's part of your DNA, is this whole concept of no small creator.
Yeah.
And I think that's important.
All right, let's talk about that really quickly. And you don't have to use this if you don't want, but I think it's interesting that Simon Sinek in his book, Start With Why, says a COO should never become the CEO after CEO leaves.
Right.
And that is exactly what happened with Apple.
It is.
And like he wrote that book years before
that
happened. And, and that's what happened. And I just thought that I read the book only after Tim Cook had taken the helm. And I thought, oh my goodness, that's exactly what happened at Apple. And he's praising Apple throughout the whole book. Just a very interesting thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that that's one of the things that it's so interesting about our culture that, like, you know, we're talking about, well, Apple's different now, and there's an assumption that we're saying it's worse.
Right.
Or it's not that. It's just different. We're just talking about the world, and the world's changing, and that's interesting. So
Same could be said about Disney when they started creating regular movies instead of animation.
Yeah.
Well, they're changing, you know.
No,
they were evolving.
Right. The core's there.
Yeah.
The heart's there.
Yeah.
Right. And when it's not, you can tell. And when it is, you know. But it's just fun to talk about. It's good stuff to talk about. Let's talk about No Small Creator.
Right. Let's do it.
No Small Creator is a hashtag movement, in essence.
No, did you start it?
I started it,
okay.
Yeah. So let's not call it a hashtag movement. Let's call it a movement that has a hashtag, right?
Yeah.
And so I was doing a rant about trying to get Boosted Board, which is this sick electronic skateboard company, to send me a free Boosted Board.
Yeah.
Me and 9 other creators, in essence. And, you know, it's pretty tongue-in-cheek, but I wanted it.
Yeah.
Don't get me wrong, I wanted it, but I didn't think it was going to happen.
Right.
And, you know, I'm doing this rant, and I'm saying small creator this, small creator that, and it's just rubbing me the wrong way, saying it the whole time I'm saying it. And I go on a side trail, and I say, and just by the way, the idea that there's a small creator, this word small creator just doesn't make sense. It doesn't compute because creation's so huge, you can't pair it with the word small.
Yeah.
And someone in my comments was like, I think he commented as like, wow, I really love what you said right there.
Yeah.
Hashtag not a small creator.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's a great idea. It just needs to be, you know,
easier.
It needs to be easier. No small creator. And it also fits. It fits in a direct statement of like, you are no small creator.
Yeah.
That's what I love to say to people.
Yeah.
You are no small creator.
Yeah.
And so this idea, you know, was born out of that video, what I said in it, and then that guy pointing out, this is cool.
Yeah.
And so I made another video that was specifically about it where I the whole point of the video is that I'm trying to print these shirts that have this hashtag on it.
Yeah.
And the shirts have the print on the inside because it's a mindset thing.
And Cody just showed me it. It's true. I saw it.
It's a real
right
shirt.
Here. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
it's on the inside. It's not on the outside because it's not about your followers and what's on the outside. It's about what's on the inside and what you have inside of you and your mindset. And so that video got some traction. Some people started using the hashtag on Instagram and Twitter, and then now on YouTube, which is like just 3 days ago, started showing hashtags right above videos.
Yeah.
And like, we're all screenshotting, like, what is this? Because it says No Small Creator above our titles. And we're like, are they like, did YouTube like find us and now they're titling it? We didn't know what it was. So, it started getting traction. And then something happened that, just blew everybody's mind, which was Peter McKinnon, who has 2.2 million subscribers currently on YouTube, reached out to me as the founder of No Small Creator and said, I want to do a video with you. Come up to Toronto.
Yeah.
And made it basically an entire video about this idea that there is no small creator, that it doesn't matter your follower count, your subscribers. None of that matters. That creation is creation is creation.
Yeah.
And you know, the reason you're doing it shouldn't be about the numbers. The reason you're doing it is because it's pure and it's amazing to take something inside of you and put it outside of you.
Yeah.
And just a game changer.
Yeah.
Absolute game changer. And so the movement grew, you know, into hundreds of people.
Wow.
You know, and the hashtag blew up, obviously, after he did. I think the video right now sits at 250K views.
Wow.
So it's a whirlwind right now. I mean, this was last week.
Yeah.
This happened last week.
Yeah.
And so we're still reeling from, in a good way, from kind of the ripple effect of this and what this means. And it's time to capitalize on it.
So cool. And we record this in mid-July. So if you're listening at the end of August, this is still fresh. So get on board with it. And
I'm excited. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, you're good.
I did a podcast a couple of months ago.
Right, I remember that.
Before any of this happened.
Yeah.
You know, before I had any, I think I had 1,500 subscribers at the time.
Yeah.
And did this podcast and, you know, just talking about a lot of the same stuff.
Right.
But without knowing where any of it was going, for sure.
Yeah.
Wanting it to go here.
Yeah.
But not knowing. And that podcast just got released yesterday.
Wow.
And I tweeted it out, like, look what's happened.
Yeah.
Since then.
Here's kind of the origin story.
Look what we were thinking. This is what we were thinking. And then this is what happened. And
so
kind
cool.
of like the proof is in the pudding sort of thing.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited for when this comes out in August.
Yeah.
To see what's happened. You know, like, let's look what's happened. And, so if you're listening to this in August, right now my subscriber count sits right at 24,000.
Yeah.
No Small Creator, I believe, has 400 people who are officially a part of it.
Yeah.
Which doesn't mean anything other than the fact that they like joined a Facebook group.
Yeah.
Anybody's a No Small Creator. You know, simply a matter of a mindset, but
so there's a Facebook
group.
Let's
see where it goes. There's a Facebook group that we're transitioning to a Discord server.
Okay.
So Discord is, if you're unfamiliar, it's basically a robust chat room.
Yeah.
That's very similar to Slack.
Yeah,
actually,
I was just gonna
with
say,
different
yeah.
channels.
Yeah.
So that's why I love it, because we use Slack in our company, so it makes perfect sense to me. But it keeps things way more organized. Like with 400 people in a Facebook group, you know, the video, everything, every post just gets pushed down immediately. It's it's impossible to keep up with.
Right.
So Discord's going to make that way more organized, and hopefully we'll be able to get some cool stuff done in terms of collaboration and what we're doing.
Super, super cool. And I think it comes back to understanding your value and understanding your worth and not putting your worth and value out on the external, but understanding that at your foundation.
Right, right. Yeah, some of those measures, you know, the measures, subscribers, all that stuff.
Yeah.
Like, it's like money.
Yeah.
It's kind of like money. And there's a caveat, there's an asterisk. Don't tune out yet, because it's important that I correct that. But it's kind of like money in that it's like, you know, a wealthy person.
Yeah.
That's a measure of the value that they contributed, hopefully, to society.
Yeah.
Someone who has a lot of subscribers on YouTube is a measure of kind of what's the collective understanding of this person's value?
Yeah.
Right? So it's a measure.
Yeah.
But it's not actually a definition.
Right.
Or an indicator.
Yeah.
At all.
Yeah.
You know, who knows? Who knows why that person only has 10 subscribers, or who knows why that other person has 10 million?
Yeah.
It's a measure, but it's an imperfect one.
Yeah.
And basically No Small Creator is about, it's so imperfect, let's just kind of stop thinking about it, stop worrying about it. The reason I threw the asterisk on there is that every subscriber,
yeah,
and literally the vlog that I dropped today is this, the importance of one.
Right.
Every subscriber is a person.
Yeah. Yeah.
A person with an almost infinite ability to affect and change the world.
Right.
So if you have one subscriber, even if you have zero subscribers, the only person who subscribes to what you're making is yourself, that's enough.
Yeah.
You're potentially affecting the world in a big way.
Yeah.
You know, Steve, we're talking about Steve Jobs,
yeah,
putting a ding in the universe.
Yeah.
Right? And so there's No Small Creator. Just do it.
Super cool. Before we wrap up this segment, I always like to ask, how can people find and connect with you?
So the best way to find me is on my YouTube channel, which we've talked about, but it's Cody Wanner. Technically, it's our Cody Wanner. but if you search Cody Wanner, I'll be the first one to pop up. And then Twitter, at Cody Wanner, Instagram, at Cody Wanner, Facebook. I'm not sure what Facebook is, but if you search Cody Wanner, there'll be a couple things that pop up.
Yeah.
It'll be that same profile. I'll try to keep my profile pictures the same across all platforms, and you'll be able to find me.
How about Cap Collective?
Cap Collective, go to capcollective.com.
Cool.
You can also go to caphbg.com. That's Charlie Alpha Papa Hotel Bravo Golf.com. And yeah, you can find us there, contact us there.
Super cool. We'll put all of that in the episode notes so they're easy to find. All you have to do is go on over there, click on over, and you can check it out. We will be back with Cody Wanner and rapid fire questions.
All right.
If you're enjoying today's episode, which I hope you are, here are a few other episodes you might love. In season 2, episode 49, our guest was Ryan Williams. He has studied and written about the influencer economy, which is so relevant to the conversation we're having today with Cody. I think you'll love that episode. In season 2, episode 30, our friends Kimmy and Pua, founders of Best Life Ever, they share about taking risks that matter. It's a super powerful episode, and we just love Kimmy and Pua. Their heartbeat and our heartbeat are so similar. And one of our other favorite guests that I think if you love this episode will really hit you hard is our episode with Jeffrey Shaw, season 1, episode 93. He talks about the uncommon entrepreneur and his journey of entrepreneurship and creating. It's super fun. Those three episodes are great places to start, but we have over 160 episodes of the Jumble Think podcast. You can pick any of them. Incredible guests, amazing lessons you can learn. So make sure you check out more episodes of the Jumble Think podcast. Now let's return to our conversation, rapid fire questions with Cody Wanner. We are back with Cody and rapid fire questions. Cody, are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you sure?
I think.
Okay. So if somebody has a big idea and dream and they don't know what to start, what is one tip you'd give them?
Put pen to paper.
Okay.
Get notes down. Just get it out of your head somehow. The action of getting it out of your head is enough to sometimes catalyze something into more.
Yeah. So, so good. What's one change you'd like to see in the world?
I want more communication, less breakdown in communication, more connectivity.
Yeah. What do you want your legacy to be?
Encouragement. Cool. I want people to say, I did something because of him.
Okay, so this is a wild card question. We've been working on this for a while, trying it out. Going to try it out with you too today. Uh-huh. What is one trend you currently see that excites you?
Automated, artificially intelligent video editing.
Is that a thing yet?
Yeah.
Oh.
So in Google,
okay,
and I know this is supposed to be rapid fire, but I'll explain it. You don't have to use it. In Google, you know, you take videos and it cuts videos from your computer.
Yeah.
Cuts a recap video from your videos.
Wow.
And that's only getting smarter and smarter with facial recognition, with
wow,
with captioning. So Once a computer knows what you're saying in your video and is able to analyze, she's smiling, he's frowning, this is supposed to be a happy video versus a sad video, I shouldn't use the frown shot, I should only use the smile shot. And then, you know, as they get more powerful,
yeah,
and they can kind of compare your videos to highly produced professional video,
mm-hmm,
and they can say, this is the best shot that they got. This is the second best shot. You know, it's only just going to get more and more beautiful and amazing and easy that anybody can do, you know, a computer. So
yeah,
I'm really excited about that. I think it's going to be a game changer for highly produced video.
Super, super cool. Where do you find inspiration?
Mostly from YouTube.
Okay.
From my YouTube community. There's a guy named Bert Cullinane up in Massachusetts.
Okay.
And he creates daily, but he uploads 5 times a week.
Right.
And just cinematic stuff. You know, he's a guy who's thinking through freelancing, making money, how to live, how to create, how to stay true to your values and your passions.
Yeah.
That's so inspiring to me.
What is one book you think every dreamer or entrepreneur should read and why?
The book you should read is, it's supposed to be rapid fire. Let me say, Start With Why.
Okay. What is one tool that is significant for the success of your business?
The internet. We wouldn't have a business without the internet. Facebook ads.
Okay. What is one habit you find helpful in your life as an entrepreneur?
Persistence.
Okay.
Just getting up and getting, you know, stepping to the plate, even when you don't feel like it, because you're committed to it.
Yeah. How do you start and finish your day?
Start my day on Instagram, email, Facebook, all the places.
Okay.
I would highly suggest not starting your day like that. I would prefer to start my day with meditation.
Okay.
I end my day most usually with my wife talking on the couch, you know, kind of trying to somehow think about what just happened today and process through it with her.
Super cool. If you weren't doing what you're doing today,
yeah,
what do you think you'd be doing?
I would hopefully be inventing things.
Okay.
Gizmos and gadgets and things that helped people, actual tangible physical things.
Super cool. And our final rapid fire question is, what is one dream you are still wanting to fulfill in your own life?
A dream that I have for my own life. I would really love to fly.
Okay.
Like with wings.
All right.
Like, you know, robotic wings.
The Michelangelo sketch thing.
Yeah.
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 I think that will probably happen. The other thing, like, very similar is just like what we're doing with the Hyperloop. I want to take a Hyperloop ride from New York City to Los Angeles in 2 hours or whatever the time's going to be.
Yeah.
I want to go that fast to a place and then maybe to London. I want the whole world to be connected like that.
Okay. As we wrap up today's episode, we always leave our guests to have a final thought. So what is your final thought for today?
Final thought is just you're so much more capable than you realize that you are. I can't even explain how little I was doing 4 years ago, 3 years ago, 2 years ago, a year ago. And I didn't think I had the capacity to do anything else. But you are so much more capable than you give yourself credit for, and you just got to get out there and get it done.
So good. Cody, it's been a blast having you over and learning more about you, getting to know you, and hear more of your story. Thanks for taking time out.
Thank you so much, Mike.
Once again, we want to thank today's guest, Cody Wanner, for taking time out, sharing his story, and giving us insights into what he's creating through the No Small Creator movement. If you want to learn more about Cody or find links to the books we talked about in this episode, make sure you check out the episode notes. You can find all the links there. Our guest on Thursday's episode is Jonathan Grzbowski. He is the co-founder of Penji, which is an on-demand graphic design membership without limitations. Super cool company, doing really cool stuff. He also hosts the number one business podcast, The Blind Entrepreneur. It's super cool. I'm actually going to be a guest on there soon, so make sure you check out both his business, that podcast, and our episode on Thursday with Jonathan Grisbowski. As we wrap up today's episode, my final thought for you today is that I completely agree. There is no such thing as a small creator. No small creators. If you're creating, if you're sharing a message, if you're building, if you're a maker, if you're an innovator, if you're an influencer, if you're doing something to change the world around you, you have significance. No matter the fear, the failure, the discouragement that you face, keep on going. That perseverance is so important. So get out there, continue that journey, make a step, a small step, a big step, but any step to make your dreams and ideas a reality. Thanks again for tuning in. Now get out there, dream big, turn those ideas into reality, and change the world around you.
Vous êtes une autre personne. Les mères de famille, les enfants peuvent également prendre un moment revitalisant dans quelques mois. Lorsque vous aurez bien saisi la technique et que vous serez maître de votre corps, vous pourrez vous décontracter même en travaillant.